Hi, I'm Vito Russo.
Hi, I'm Marcia Palling, and this is Our Time. First, there was The Well of Loneliness, Oscar Wilde, and, if you could find a copy of it, E.M. Forster's Maurice. Then there was the tawdry paperbacks phase, when people like Anne steamy novels in the 50s put them out by the ream to keep us going when we had so little to go on. No matter how you define gay literature today, there's a hell of a lot more to choose from, thanks to the efforts and courage of a great many gay and lesbian writers. The first gay novel I read, or the novel I could consider gay, is Ruby Fruit Jungle, Rita Mae Brown's hilarious account of growing up in the South as a lesbian. Vito, what was the first gay book you read?
I think the first gay book I read was probably a paperback by Jay Little. That doesn't sound like a pseudonym, does it? It was called Maybe Tomorrow, and the hero was Gaylord LeClaire, a troubled teenage high school student. His nickname was Gay, and I liked it because it had a happy ending. He ended up marrying the high school football star. Otherwise, gay books, I think probably Anti-Mame by Patrick Dennis, which everybody thought was a gay book except Patrick Dennis, and the biography of Shelley Winters, which people still think is a gay book. But tonight on Our Time, I think we'll be taking a look at real lesbian and gay writers, real lesbian and gay writing, and some of the issues in lesbian and gay publishing in the last decade. I'll be talking to Felice Picano, who is one of the most popular gay authors writing today, and also has his own small press, Seahorse. And also, we'll be dealing with the issue of censorship in the lesbian and gay community. I'm going to talk to Craig Rodwell, who is the proprietor of the Oscar Wilde Bookshop. And Our Times co-producer Barbara Kerr will talk to Karen London at Womanbooks. Marcia?
I'll also be talking to Jill Johnston, former dance critic at The Village Voice and author of Lesbian Nation. Later on, I'll be talking to two gay Cuban writers, Rinaldo Arenas and Rene Cifuentes, who left Cuba on the Mariel Flotilla in 1980. Finally, we'll conclude our program tonight with a tribute to Tennessee Williams. By the way, do you know where the word gay comes from? We asked some people on the street what they thought. Let's take a peek at some of their answers.
The word gay. Do you know where the word gay comes from? And do you think you like it?
Well, it has a certain flair to it, I guess.
I thought it came from the 50s, from the 1950s. I thought that word came into use to describe gay people. It's sort of like, I think it originally was derogatory, right. But it became used not derogatorily because we're so happy all the time.
The Oscar Wilde Memorial Bookshop has been around for 16 years. It's the oldest gay liberation bookstore in the country. Craig Rodwell has been the proprietor of the Oscar Wilde Bookshop for 16 years, began it, runs it, and knows all about running a gay bookstore. Would you more likely to carry things that people can't get in their local bookstore? I mean, that's not a gay bookstore.
That's part of what we carry. I mean, about half of our stock is from gay and lesbian small presses around the country. Right. Many bookstores, especially your larger chain operations, just will not carry small press titles, whether they're gay or not gay.
Right.
And especially in the last 5 years, when there are a lot of gay and lesbian small presses, that is a particular function that gay and lesbian bookshops around the country fulfill.
I know that there are certain things you don't carry. Do you have a criteria for racist or sexist inclusions? For instance, you don't carry The Advocate.
Right.
Now you don't carry Philadelphia Gay News.
Maybe right.
You could talk a little bit about the incidents which prompted your decision not to carry those titles.
Well, generally we don't carry most gay periodicals, as far as that goes. Most gay periodicals are part of the sex industry. I'm talking about things like The Advocate, Numbers, Blue Boy, Honcho. I can go on and on and on. There's
right.
Hundreds of them. And I feel that a clear line has to be drawn between the gay and lesbian independent movement and what's coming out of it, and that which is done strictly to exploit our sexuality. So that's the basic criteria. In terms of Philadelphia Gay News, their advertising, and this goes back for about 3 years, they allow people in personal ads to say, no, I forget the exact wording, but the essence is no fats, no druggies, no addicts, no blacks. And that's just plain insulting and at the very least insensitive to third world people. Mm-hmm. It's one thing to say GWM or GBM seek same.
Right.
While we wished we lived in a world where people didn't regard race as a factor, it is the reality of living, people do. But to say no drug addicts, junkies, or blacks, that's another story.
Womanbooks has been here since 1975, and in that time I've observed that, I guess especially comparing notes in the informal network of women's bookstores at the various women in print conferences, that when this question comes up, and it has come up before, that it's the particular controversy might be new, but the issue of censorship is one that's been around a long time. And for us at Womanbooks, it's been part of the vision of what this store is about, that it tends to be inclusive rather than exclusive. And we very much let our customers stock the store. We carry about 5,000 or 6,000 titles. We couldn't possibly read them all, and in fact, if we did, we might be rather upset by it. The standards are stricter in the children's books about being non-sexist and non-racist. But as far as the rest of the store goes, we don't have to agree with what's in these books in order for them to be here, for the books to be here, and for us to work here.
Do you have conflicts with any of the people who come in here? Are there any complaints about the books that you do carry?
Complaints is one way of looking at it. We also count on customers for feedback of what we ought to have that we don't and what people have found objectionable and why. I can't ever think of something being controversial here the way I have understood situations to come up in other bookstores and in other cities. We hear out what it is that somebody has a problem with, and then we'll discuss it amongst ourselves, and I could go into further what some of the criteria would be and how we get around various issues, which is, in so many ways, we're very fortunate that we're in New York City, and there are a lot of other bookstores, so that a lot of things that might be marginal, if we can safely say that it's going to be available on the newsstand on the corner or another large bookstore, general bookstore down the street, or even in another part of town, then we're relieved from knowing that because we're not carrying it, it's not that you can't get it, it's over there. And we'll help you to find it. We just don't need to devote our space to it or tie up our cash in buying it. But we're not keeping you from it. Where we feel quite differently and very strongly, and I guess we're at one end of a fringe of women's and gay bookstores, is this, that censorship seems to come up a lot more around work written by and published by ourselves. We seem to be much harder on each other than we are on the folks out there. Maybe our expectations are higher, so our disappointments are greater when it doesn't seem to be exactly what we would want. And that's part of what a woman's bookstore is, where you can find something that just isn't out there in the world, that they don't have at a B. Dalton's. And if we weren't to carry it, then that would be censorship because he couldn't find it.
A number of other women's bookstores have censored certain books, and I'm thinking in particular of the Heresy sex issue, What Color Is Your Handkerchief and Coming to Power. I was wondering if there's been a problem here with those books.
Well, again, I heard stories of how it's been an issue at other stores. It hasn't been here, either from our customers or amongst ourselves. Womanbooks has an identity, and part of that identity and definition is you're going to find those books here.
I have with me here tonight Jill Johnston. Jill was a dance critic for the Village Voice during the heyday of the 60s counterculture. She brought to our attention such artists as Merce Cunningham, John Cage, Robert Rauschenberg, Yvonne Rainer, and the Judson Church Group. Years later, in the early 70s, Jill published Lesbian Nation, a groundbreaking book that changed the life of lesbians and gay men. Recently, Jill has just put out the first volume of what will be a three-volume autobiography. It's entitled Motherbound. Jill, what have you been doing in the years between the writing of Lesbian Nation and the publication of Motherbound?
Well, first I was getting over Lesbian Nation.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I had to get over the repercussions of that book, and figure out a new life after that, and a new style, and get busy on this autobiography. So I've been working on this since about 1975.
On the autobiography. Mm-hmm. What were some of the repercussions of Lesbian Nation?
Well, one of them was going around the country and being interviewed by lots of people who were very hostile.
A drag.
And and I'm somebody who liked being liked by people, and I found this a stunning reverse for my life.
Hostile because of the book, because you're gay, because...
Yeah, I had we were riding on a certain crest of popularity in New York. And at that time, you know, it was the big issue of the moment,
right.
71, 72, 73. And I think I was misled by the popularity of the issue, which was a commercial media thing, you know, and all of that, to imagine from the provincial viewpoint of New York that that people were more receptive to the issue. And I found out that they were not, and that the backlash was very quick.
Did you find a backlash in New York, or just when you left New York to tour?
Well, I did in New York in the sense that, after all, there were the pundits in New York, I mean, the establishment, right? And they acted quite rather quickly.
Literary pundits,
well,
TV, media, radio?
All kinds of media, like Viva, I remember, for instance. You know, Viva magazine,
yeah,
or something. I mean, like Penthouse, or... But I remember them having a page of people to remember and people to forget, and one day there was, you know, like that.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Oh, that's outrageous. Right. Do you think it was just pure homophobia?
No, yeah.
Just an inability to accept gay women and lesbians?
Yeah, it was too much. I remember walking into the Village Voice one day, and a woman there who worked in the office for years, and she had heard that my book was coming out, and it was published by a major publisher, and it was called Lesbian Nation. And she was it was beyond her credulity to imagine that she just thought the whole country would be seized, perhaps, with a lesbian mania, you know, if a major publisher brought out a book like this. Yeah, right. And so I think that the media acted quickly.
You mean to poo-poo it, to squash it?
Definitely. Of
course. Oh. Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, you probably know that it wasn't squashed, and a lot of people read
the
book.
Of course. To me, it was like, at that moment, people like myself were running around urging people to come out and to withdraw their commitments to men. And I think that looking back, it was kind of a frantic moment in the movement. That is, that everybody who could be saved, as it were, was being rushed, past the barricades that the media police were quickly fastening into place.
Uh-huh. Okay,
there's one way of looking at it.
Do you mean that it was a frantic moment that people were being encouraged to come out a great deal in spite of the backlash that was forming?
Yeah, you could sense that the barricades were being put back into place, and everybody. And there was a big, you know how that is, in, I don't know what analogy to use, in a revolution,
yeah,
they're closing the barricades and people are rushing through to get to the Bastille or whatever it is.
Mm. You know. Was lesbianism the Bastille?
What do you mean?
I don't know.
Bastille of what?
Oh, all right.
To go for an unpopular cause like that without understanding the consequences, you might think twice that.
Do you think that since those early days that lesbians have retrenched, or lesbians and gay men have pulled back, become more respectable, become more cautious, careful?
Oh, sure, yeah. And the movement, is the way I understand it, has become more civil rights oriented, right? I mean, more working through legal channels,
uh-huh,
for passage, uh-huh, of bills and stuff like that.
Rather than
going around, you know, yelling with your... It's not so emotional or rhetorical,
all
those things.
Yeah, it's not. Do you think that's a turn for the better?
I don't see it that way. I just see that there's a life to movements. You know, this thing happens now, and now this thing happens next, and there's an evolution in any particular movement towards liberation.
Mm. I want to ask you a little bit about Mother Bound specifically. This, there's a lot more attention to the psychological, a lot more analysis and introspection in Mother Bound than there is into the traditional autobiography. How did you arrive at that approach?
Well, I'm introspective by nature, or I have been for a long time, and so it came naturally to me to work with my life that way. But it's no more introspective than any analytical situation, right? That's the way people analyze themselves, or a way, you know, therapeutic situations.
Yeah. Right. No, the difference is that not all autobiographies are analytical in that way.
Yeah. Right.
What did you hope your readers to get out of this book?
Well, I would hope to stimulate people to make connections with their own lives the way I have. I think that it's a useful tool to think about your life in this way, making connections the way I do, and I think it's just one wants to know oneself as fully as possible, and it's in that spirit that I make the contribution.
Okay.
The overall title, by the way, is for the three volumes,
yes,
is Autobiography in Search of a Father.
Right. Right. Okay. Thank you. You, in an earlier conversation, you mentioned that your life, you felt your life was extreme, but paradigmatic, and I was wondering if you could explain that.
Yeah, the issue around which I've built this autobiography is my illegitimacy, which is now considered by many to be a Victorian issue. But it was, my mother was born in 1901, and it was a very heavy thing for her to deal with. And since my story was so extreme in terms of how my mother dealt with it, through secrecy and lying and conniving and making up a story and lying to me and the absence of a father, and therefore of the reality principle represented by the patriarchy, I feel it's paradigmatic of women's ignorant situation in relation to that reality principle, because mine was so extreme. I had to come from so far under to understand what a father represented
in our society.
Yeah.
Yeah. You mentioned that you felt that you were in your early years that you had no idea about the parameters of reality and would go crashing into them only to be slapped down. Is that what you're getting at here?
Yeah. Yes. No limits. There were no. From my mother's kind of conditioning on me, I felt that I could do anything. Anything was possible.
And you discovered that you couldn't?
No. Yes. And I didn't know why.
Do you feel that the reason why is because you're a woman?
Well, that's a lot of the reason why. It's not. I do feel that one. I still feel that one can do anything, but that there are ways to do things. I didn't have a sense of how you should do things in what particular setting. So, you know, my feeling of the appropriate was missing. I had good manners and all of that, but.
nice female training. I think we have to wrap up, but I want to ask one more question, which is, do you have any comment on the lesbian and gay movements now? You've been through a repressive 50s and the crazy 60s and the early enthusiastic 70s for gay lib. And how about comments for the future, or for us? Are we going in the right direction?
Well, I don't see how we can help it. Yeah, going in the right direction. So it's an every movement is an evolution, and it moves towards liberation, don't you think?
I worry about backlash. I mean, I worry
that's
about
inevitable. Always, it's like ocean waves comes and it goes, and then it builds up momentum, and then it falls back again.
And for the gays and lesbians ourselves to weather that, or what? I mean, what?
Yes, I think it's very tough. You know, I feel from my history with Lesbian Nation that it's rough. The tendency is to scurry back into the closet.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's also a concern about 10 years ago, as you said, people were so enthusiastic about coming out, and you grow up and then you get cautious, and then how do you build a movement out of people who are becoming more cautious?
Well, then more crazy people come along.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
I think that's all the time we have. Thank you very much for coming on our show. And now I think we're going to have a look at some more answers to our question of the week.
This portion of our time is brought to you by Christopher Street Magazine.
Do you know where the word gay comes from?
No, but I don't like it, and I never have at all. It comes from France, I'm almost sure. But other than that, I don't really know where it comes from or why.
Also, do you know where the word gay comes from?
I don't know. It's just a euphemism, I guess, for a way of life.
No, I don't know where it comes from. I'd like to know.
Oh, it's fine with me. It is easier to say than homosexual. It's simpler. You know, the average stupid person can remember it more easily than a multisyllabic word.
Happy. In the 20s and 30s, honey. Gay meant happy. Meant alive.
No, I really don't know what the derivation of the word is, gay, in this case.
Do you know where the word gay comes from?
No.
No, I don't. Gay to me is happy. I don't know, you know, why it's associated with homosexuals.
No, I do not.
Do you know where the word gay comes from?
No. French? France? What does it mean?
Do you know where the word gay comes from?
That street over there.
Do you think it's a good word for homosexuals?
It's from the 20s, I guess, isn't it? You know, when you had a gay old time. I don't know how it, you know, gets connected, but, you know, it's a good word, I guess.
Do you have any idea where the word gay comes from?
Heavens, no. I think the names are unfortunate. I mean, gay sounds so trivial, and homosexual sounds so scientific. Was there something like Uranian at one time?
That's right.
I've often thought I'd like to be called a Uranian. Of course, it sounds like somebody out of outer space, but...
In the last 10 years, more and more lesbian and gay writing, especially poetry, has begun to be published by some of the small presses that are springing up all over the country. And in coming weeks on Our Time, we're going to do profiles of some of them, including Kitchen Table Women of Color Press right here in Brooklyn. And tonight we'd like to talk a little bit about one of the most successful of these small publishing houses, Felice Picano's Seahorse Press. Felice Picano, the author of Late in the Season, The Lure, and An Asian Minor, operates Seahorse Press out of his Greenwich Village house, where I interviewed him about gay writing, small presses, and the phenomenal success of books that Seahorses published, like Harvey Fierstein's Torch Song Trilogy and Clark Henley's The Butch Manual. Listen. Lure, a psychosexual thriller set in New York's gay underground. Late in the season, an unusual love triangle set on Fire Island. The author, Felice Picano. Prolific and popular authors working today. He has written 7 other books. He's also responsible for a collection of lesbian and gay writings and an anthology of short stories that'll be out this spring. In addition, he's the book editor for the New York Native. He's the co-founder of Gay Presses of New York, and he is the publisher and founder of Seahorse Press, one of the most distinguished gay publishing houses in the nation. Felice, one of the first questions I want to ask is a fundamental question, and it has to do with what is a gay book? How do you define a gay book?
It's a book that is not intended for the widest possible audience, but for a specific audience who will buy it.
So the phrase gay book has more to do with who's reading it than what the book is about.
Who's buying it, who's reading it, absolutely. That's true now. That wasn't so in the palmy days of 1976 to 1978, when it was believed by the commercial publishing houses that there was an enormous potential gay market out there, and that they could sell books in the millions, as they do, you know, Colleen McCulloch or whatever. Mm-hmm. But that's turned out to be so, because most of those books turned out to have an upper limit to how many copies could be sold, how many people would buy them. So nowadays, I would have to say it is a genre book.
Is considered good, it gets reviewed in the straight press and everybody goes to it, and it's not a gay restaurant anymore. That applies, I think, also to gay writers, gay filmmakers. Do you ever have any trouble with being identified as a gay writer?
Coming out as a writer, it really took some doing, in that I knew that I had a readership. Mm-hmm. And I was in fact testing my readership in a certain sense, or, you know, by publishing, you know, a book that was going to be known as a gay book, let's face it. Mm-hmm. And so I was testing myself, and I said, well, my belief was that nothing too much was going to change, mm-hmm. or that I could only gain merit somewhere from it. You know, I'm basically an optimistic person, so
right.
I didn't think it would be too terrible,
right.
You know. But first of all, I discovered by publishing that book, I discovered that a lot of my previous gay readers started writing to me, that I'd already developed a gay readership.
In your non-gay work.
In my non-gay work. So that was step number one. Another interesting sidelight is that I found a lot of my regular readers came back to read my gay books.
Uh-huh.
They didn't disappear on me.
That's what I was going to ask.
They didn't
lose your straight readers.
Not at all. Not at all. I mean, I don't know directly. All I know is that my fan mail continues at a constant rate. It hasn't declined.
In the 1970s, I think, there was a group of gay literati in New York, which sort of formed a renaissance of gay lit. I think it was called the Lavender Quill at one point. Is that still going on? Is it over? What happened with that?
As far as I know, what happened in the late 70s and the early 80s was a brand new thing. It was experimental. It's still sort of going on. And the work that I'm doing, people are doing, is, you know, grew out of it all. I'd mm-hmm. say. So I don't think it will, you know, it may be a passing thing, but I think it's set down certain roots into gay life and gay society, and into, you know, all those potential gay writers out there. I mean, I get letters of inquiries and manuscripts and whatever, and there are thousands and thousands of them.
Yeah.
So in fact, it accomplished a lot.
Well, you run Seahorse Press. You are the founder and publisher.
Right.
Seahorse Press. Seahorse Press is a gay publishing house.
That is a specifically gay publishing house, gay and lesbian.
And how long has that been going on?
I formed it in the end of 1977. The first book was published in 1978.
What made you do this?
I have friends who are in publishing, and who, I must say, now are in important positions in publishing. They're heads of paperback houses and hardcover houses and whatever. And I was able to track what was going on with gay books very, very early on, and through them, right? So it was very clear to me that they were looking for specific books that they were going to try and push to the gay market, or what they perceived of as the gay market. They were looking for big, quote, big novels. They were looking for breakthrough biographies or tell-it-all biographies and how-to books. Mm-hmm. They weren't looking for gay or lesbian literary novels. They weren't looking for poetry. They weren't looking for drama. So I said, well, somebody's got to publish these things. They're out there. So I formed Seahorse Press to do exactly that, to publish what I perceived that the larger commercial houses were not publishing.
You told me a story once about how you got the title for Seahorse Press. It happened in Key West.
In Key West.
I'd like you to tell that story.
Okay.
Because it's nice. It's interesting.
It's like that. There's a little pier on what's known as the gay beach there. And I met a young man there who had a seahorse tattooed on his bicep. And I said, oh, that's very pretty. You know, that's very nice. What's that all about? And he said, well, I'm a gay artist, and the seahorse is one of the two or three creatures in nature in which the male actually bears the young. So by using seahorse as a signal, it says that I am a gay creative man.
What have been Seahorse's most particularly stunning successes?
Well, it depends upon what you mean by success. The basic thing that we've been able to do is we've been able to sell large quantities of gay poetry. Mm-hmm. So nobody is publishing gay poetry except the small gay presses in this country. And we're able to sell 2,000 and 3,000 copies, and maybe more, who knows, they're still continuing. And when you consider that people like John Ashbery sell 900 copies of their book,
right,
numbers like that are very large. So, and that's a crossover market because there is a poetry market.
Right.
And if it's good poetry and it gets around, people who are interested in poetry will read it no matter whether it's gay or not.
Right.
The anthology that I edited several years ago called The True Likeness, Lesbian and Gay Writing Today, that has been critically successful. Mm-hmm. The most popular books that Seahorse has done have been my book called An Asian Minor, which was an illustrated novel,
right,
and something we're going to be doing more of. I really
believe
in the idea of doing illustrations in texts. And just now we have the Butch Manual out, which is, I'm told, the best-selling gay book in the country.
Yeah, you see it everywhere.
Yeah,
now. It's amazing.
Card stores and things like that.
What happened with Torch Song Trilogy? You sort of published that in a very limited edition, didn't you?
Okay, that's something else now. That's Gay Presses of New York. The first book we chose was Harvey Fierstein's Torch Song Trilogy, which turned out to be inspired first choice.
Yeah.
But this one, we published it before the trilogy had actually been performed, all three plays at once.
Anywhere,
yeah. We published it in June of 1981, and then in September it opened off-Broadway,
right,
as a trilogy. Each one of us had separately and together seen the three plays, and
right,
we thought they were good.
Yeah.
And Harvey said, oh, this would make a wonderful book, and I want to see all three plays together. So we said yes. So we published 2,000 copies of it, which is a standard first print run for a play from a small press by an unknown gay playwright, which is what he was.
And now,
P.S., 2 years later, we have 17,000 copies in print, and we're constantly running out of it. And we have two of the large commercial houses on our backs, rights or distribution rights or something.
Well, we've left Seahorse Press, and we have with us here tonight two gay writers from Cuba who were able to leave that country on the 1980 Mario Flotilla. Leonardo Arenas has 9 books in print of novels and short stories. They've been published in France, Spain, Mexico, and Venezuela. Although only one of his books, Celestino Before the Dawn, his first book, I believe, was allowed to be published in Cuba, he became quite well known there, and in spite of the fact that that book was only able to go through one printing. While in Cuba, Reynaldo was an editor at the Cuban Book Institute, which is part of the Ministry of Culture in Havana, and an editor at the Cuban Writers Union. Since coming to this country, he's been a visiting professor at the Florida International University, and as of this year, he's visiting professor at the Center for Inter-American Studies here in New York. In 1982, Reynaldo was a recipient of a Guggenheim Fellowship. René Cifuentes is a writer of short stories and poems and was imprisoned for 3 years in Cuba for trying to leave the country with his father. His father was given 9 years in prison. René and his father were able to leave Cuba in the 1980 flotilla. Now René is working on his first book and is on the board of editors of a new publication called Mario Magazine. This is a literary magazine designed to present the work of those Cubans who came over on the flotilla. Reynaldo is one of the three chief editors of that publication. I'd like to hear from both of you why you came to the United States. Rinaldo?
Yes. In my case, I leave Cuba because I am a writer and I gay people. So I was discriminated in Cuba. I remember, for example, my second novel, Hallucination, was prohibited in Cuba because I refer of the life of the gay people. And I was in prison for 1 year only for the only fact that I was gay. And even I had been rejected from the university in Cuba, the Havana University, because I was studying, and they discovered I was a gay person, and I stopped studying. So like many people like me who need freedom to continue living, to continue writing, it was very, very difficult for me to still alive in Cuba. In this moment, I have the opportunity in the Marielle Baudelaire, and I left Cuba at this time.
And you, Renee?
Well, in my case, after I was in jail for 3 years, I have no choice to get to the school or to be published or nothing, do nothing there, really. And that was one of the reasons.
Were you in prison because you were gay?
No, I was in prison because I tried to escape Cuba. That is the reason that I was in jail.
Did you try to escape because you were discriminated against because you were gay?
Yes.
Yes, and your father, what were his reasons?
Well, my father was tried to help me, you know, to go out of Cuba.
Does he know you're gay?
Yes, he did.
Is that why he tried to help you leave?
Yeah.
Yeah. And your father's living in this country now?
He's living in California now.
In California. He's got better weather than we do. You mentioned discrimination in the universities. What about in other forms of daily life, discrimination against gay people?
Yes. For example, at the university, they used to do in Cuba that they say depuration. Depuration means that they has a report from all the students. After they realize that the students are gay people, they can continue studying at university.
Okay.
So there are many, many gay persons in Cuba that never get university.
Oh.
And for example, I remember in the speech of Fidel Castro in 1971, he said that all the gay people are considered like pathologic illness. So they have to be separated from the university and from the, for example, from the theater and from all the jobs who has relation with the art or the publics of the university or the school, for example. Any gay person in Cuba can be professor, for example.
Uh-huh. And this you is can't have contact with other people because you're supposedly ill, sick?
Uh-huh. Yes, we can transmit this kind of illness to
uh-huh.
the
to they think
the,
your cat people
person.
Will catch it, huh?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Well, in our earlier conversation, you mentioned something about concentration camps in the 60s. Could you talk, maybe Renee, could you talk about
here,
that?
Yeah, I think we
would
do it better.
Rinaldo?
Yes, I remember I had many friends in this time who was sent to the concentration camp.
In the
60s? In the 60s. And in this concentration camp, many of my friends was killed. I remember one that's a writer who has published one book in Cuba. The title of the book was Depression, El Regalo in Spanish, and his name is Nelson Rodriguez Leyva. He was sent to the concentration camp in 1964, and he was 3 years in the concentration camp, and they who was killed by the government, by the police.
He was killed there.
He's there, yes. I have many friends who have been in the concentration camp, and then some they are here living in the United States, and another person was killed, was living in Cuba. And because it was terrible, the person, for example, the governor used to pick up the people, the gay people in the street. And sometimes they were picked up on the street and they were sent directly to the concentration camp.
Just liquidated right there.
Yes, yes.
For being gay.
And for example, the CDR, the Committee of the Revolution, there are some institutions there in each block of all the city in Cuba. And this person, for example, made a report from you, and this person says you are gay people, you can be sent to the concentration
uh-huh.
camp.
You mean they're squealing on you?
Squealing, yes.
Yeah. Okay. Are there still such camps for gay people in Cuba?
No, in the same way now, because this camp, the name was UMAT, the United Military to Increase Production. Now, this not the same names, but the same place. That means, for example, I was in prison for being gay. And I remember the gay people was sent when they left the prison to the concentration camp to work. No, they're not the same names, but the same place and the same way to, uh-huh. to trade them.
Yeah. So gay people can still be picked up in Cuba and sent to these work camps, concentration camps, for being gay today in Cuba, still?
Today.
Okay. I'm not sure if all of us knew that here. I wanted to ask you something about, it's been pointed out to me that there's a difference in Cuba between the way an active gay man would be treated and the way a passive gay man would be treated. Could you talk about that difference?
Well, we came from a machista culture, from Spain and everything, and of course they considered the macho, the active man, more like a man, and the other is more they consider more gay.
More like a woman?
More like a woman.
Is the passive gay man discriminated against more?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Do you think, how does this tie in with their attitude towards women?
It's the same thing. They discriminate less the woman because they came with machismo, so that mean the woman, they accept more, have problem the lesbian too, but they accept more the lesbian than the men's gay there.
Do you think gay men discriminated against more than lesbians in Cuba?
Yes.
So it's not as dangerous to be a lesbian in Cuba?
It's dangerous.
It's dangerous.
A little less.
Were lesbians sent to these work camps?
I think they are sent to another kind of prison. For example, in Cuba, there are three or four prisons special for lesbian or for women. For example, one says America Libre, that are Free America. It's very
ironic.
It's under names.
That's the name of the prison, Free America.
Free America. It's special for the women. And between many women, there are lesbian women.
In the prison.
And another prison was Nueva Amanecer.
Is there the same discrimination in the university and in terms of jobs for lesbians as gay men?
Sometimes, yes. Especially since the lesbian they like to work, for example, at the theater, at the artist's job, for example, because it's prohibited for all the gay people. And the only job we have choose for the gay people is agriculture, for example.
Agriculture,
yes.
Oh, they let you deal with the food, but not with people, huh? Mm-hmm. Before we finish, I'd like to ask you, how do you feel about the treatment of gays in this country now that you've been here?
Okay.
Go ahead, Renee.
I think we still have some problem, I'm sure about it, but it's not like Cuba, never.
It's not like Cuba, not yet.
At least we walk on the street and we have no people to bother us, you know, police doesn't ask you for papers. You know, in Cuba, every time you walk in the street, you have to show your paper.
Whether you're gay or not, everybody or just gay people?
Well, everybody and more if you are gay. You know, they try to you have to comprove what you're doing, the reason why you're walking in specific areas.
Are there gay areas in Cuba, in Cuban cities?
No, but there are places where the gay people used to go, but they are prohibited. For example, the place like say Copelia or Capri, sometimes the people pick up all the person who are there, even people who are not gay, can be collecting by the police.
You are in a very dangerous area.
Yes. Uh-huh.
What do you think about the gay lifestyle here?
I don't know really very, very deeply the situation of the gay people here, but I think for me it's wonderful that I can be what I am, for example. I can say all that I like to say. I can write all the things that I would like to write, for example. In Cuba, we can exist it. Mm-hmm. We can deny ourselves. It's terrible. I think here there are many prejudices and we have to fight against many, many problems. But at least we can fight. In Cuba, we can deny all that we are. It's a problem. It's a terrible problem in Cuba.
Do you see any solution to the situation in Cuba? Do you have to combat Catholicism or the leftist ideology? How can gays make life better for themselves there?
Well, the solution is go back to the democratic Well, finish with the dictatorship. It's the only solution.
But I think the gays is song that very powerful. For example, Castro, they say that they cleaned Cuba of the gay people from Mariel. But now I have known that many, many gay people, new gay people, people who are 15, 16 years old, but now I understand.
The revolution.
You were?
I was 5 years when the revolution came to the power.
Right.
So I have no reason to be, I don't know, to have nothing against the revolution, but here I am.
Yeah, well, you're probably right. There are always be more gay people, and eventually they'll have to come to terms with it because they didn't all leave on the Mariel. There'll be young people coming up. Mm-hmm. I think that's all the time we have. Thank you very much for bearing with my English and for being with us here tonight. We're going to conclude our show now with a tribute to Tennessee Williams by some of his friends in the theater.
Tennessee Williams died here at the Hotel Elise in Manhattan on February 24. Williams, who was 71 at the time of his death, was generally regarded as America's greatest living playwright. During a theatrical career that spanned more than four decades, he created such memorable works as A Streetcar Named Desire, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, The Glass Menagerie, and Suddenly Last Summer. Tennessee Williams won the Pulitzer Prize several times and was awarded the Medal of Freedom by President Jimmy Carter. Tennessee Williams was also America's most prominent gay writer. He never tried to hide the fact that he was gay, and this honesty inspired and encouraged the countless numbers of gay men and women who loved his work. We at Our Time News interviewed several people who knew and admired Mr. Williams for our tribute to him.
I know him for 30 years, and we began working together. You know, he used to come to my studio and work with me. It's a long time ago. I met him in Paris. He was having lunch with John Cromwell, and I asked John if I could meet Mr. Williams. And I went and had coffee with them at the Café de Flore. And the first thing Tennessee asked me was if Greek people were hairy. So I opened my shirt and I showed my chest. And he said he was going to Greece. He hated hairy people.
He laughed all the time. He had this wonderful, wonderful, full, chuckly laughter that seemed to come out with a southern accent. He's the only person I ever knew who laughed with an accent.
If there was any one particular aspect of Williams's genius that you would care to pinpoint, what would it be?
I think he was one of the greatest capturers of the American idiom. He wrote in a colloquial but very poetic American English.
Love and work stand out for me. He worked every day of his life. He wrote 5 hours a day. He swam every day. So that I think throughout the most difficult times that he had with drink, drugs, disappointments, he maintained that work discipline and also the discipline of exercise.
How would you say that Tennessee Williams' homosexuality was a factor in his creativity?
He found he was a victim. Whether he was or not makes no difference. He found he was, and this never left him.
Out of the deepest recesses of his psyche, and I don't think that can be characterized as sexual. So he wrote out of all of him.
Yeah, I once said to him, I'm so glad you know you're out of the closet. I mean, because you're such a big name, so it's a very wonderful thing to do. And he said, well, baby, I was out of the closet a long time ago, before even the movement started.
Overall, how would you assess Tennessee Williams' contribution to American theater?
I think his contribution is to really American literature. Of course, the theater. But the theater, the Broadway theater, was too small a stage for his genius. It was cramping him. And I think you have to say of Tennessee Williams that his contribution was not only to American literature, but to world literature.
Tennessee Williams' women were survivors, no matter how damaged they were by man, a specific man or mankind, humankind. And for me, particularly, on reflection over the last 10 years or so, since my consciousness has been raised as a woman, I have realized on looking back on Tennessee Williams' work that he anticipated in some kind of way for for the world, I think, the necessity that women do pay attention to themselves.
I think for me he's the greatest playwright this country produced. Not only this country, but as a matter of fact, one of the greatest playwrights of the 20th century. Because he transcended reality to something so poetic that very few people did before. He was self-taught, but he worked every day, at least the last 10 years when I saw him quite a lot. He always worked every day painting when he was not writing. I guess he translated his images, his mental images into painting.
Tennessee Williams was not just an American dramatist. He had written some of the most brilliant short stories in the American language. He was also a very distinguished poet, so that is why you have to say he's not just a great dramatist, but he's a great American writer.
I suppose you could regard Mr. Williams as a kind of American Baudelaire. That is to say, his life has been presented to us as murky, dark, grief-stricken, sick, and I think this is possibly so, and it is possibly out of this that he built his plays. But the play's chief advantage is that this particular quality, whether real or imagined, is what gave him his sense of pity for the people of the world who feel they have had to fight with singular disadvantages. In all his plays, because the chief disadvantage is the disadvantage of being a woman.
Tennessee was a poet with special insights all over the world, all over the lot, so yes, his women are special.
I think it was a great pity and a sort of insult to America itself that Tennessee Williams never won the Nobel Prize. But we must remember that Marcel Proust, James Joyce, Tolstoy, Ibsen, Joseph Conrad, Chekhov also never won the Nobel Prize, so perhaps he's in very good company.
This is something I feel strongly about Tennessee Williams. I think he was writing it about himself. I don't ask for your pity, but only for your understanding. Not even that. No. Just for your recognition of me and you and the enemy time in all of us. Chance Wayne, sweet bird of youth. Tennessee Williams, thank you. I love you, Tennessee. Let him rest, let his soul rest, and his work will continue forever.
This is Julius's, one of the city's oldest drinking spots and one of the oldest gay bars. In 1965, a patron was arrested here by an undercover cop for making too friendly a proposition. Based on this incident alone, the state liquor authority tried to suspend Julius's liquor license. Keith Younger, a patron, recalls the time.
Police harassment was a fact of life then, but it didn't stop anybody from going out. If you went to a bar frequently, you always knew where the back door was, just in case. Bars tried not to become totally gay. Julius's, every other weekend, you couldn't get in without a girl. We felt fortunate just to have a bar to go to.
The patron was found not guilty at trial, and the state appeals court ruled that the liquor authority had no right to suspend Julius's liquor license for a single incident of homosexual conduct.
In coming weeks on Our Time, you'll meet Sister Missionary Position of the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence in San Francisco, who will talk to us about the politics of drag and the drag of politics. Also, we're going to be spending more time in the third world lesbian and gay community, and we'll be examining racism. which among gay people is probably just as pervasive, if not more so, than it is in the straight community. Also in future weeks, we'll take you to a glittering Hollywood awards ceremony where the Alliance for Gay Artists in the Entertainment Industry give out their annual awards with the help of Robert Preston, Bernadette Peters, Lynn Redgrave, Gregory Harrison, and Linda Levin. So stay around.
We'll also be having a show devoted to gay entertainers, one of whom will be Harvey Fierstein, author and star of A Torch Song Trilogy, a play about a gay man that was first produced by the Glines and is now playing on Broadway, for the two of you who haven't already been there to see it. One of my favorite projects coming up in our shows is our show devoted to drag. Well, Vito and I will be having some of our own antics in store for you. If you support our show, or if you have comments to tell us, either words of encouragement or helpful hints, please drop us a letter, a postcard, a few lines, and send them to Our Time, WNYC TV, 1 Center Street, New York, New York, 1007. I'm Marcia Pally, and for Vito Russo and myself, thank you and good night.
Do you have any idea where the word gay comes from?
Yes, it's actually from France, I believe, medieval times, and it was G-A-I, and it referred to, I think originally, people that were entertainers, but at that time, actors were primarily homosexual anyways, and the word came to be associated with homosexuals. So you see, the charge that we have taken a perfectly good word and ruined it is not true. It was ours first.